Welcome, members and friends of the Churchill Club. This is our ninth annual startup program. Thankfully hosted by Guy Kawasaki yet again. Please, round of applause. So thank you also to Fenwick and West for sponsoring tonight's program. Our program sponsors are a very important part of what we do, and we really appreciate their support of bringing this material to you. If you're not a member of the club and you enjoy tonight's program, I'd encourage you to become a member. And you just go to www.churchillclub.org, and there's also material on your table. We've got some great upcoming programs, including on September 14th, Small is Beautiful, the new venture mantra with Bill Reichert, also of Garage Technology Ventures. Lead a discussion of how boutique segmented venture funds are building the next generation companies. And we've got on October 19th, former HP CEO Carly Fiorina talking about the release of her new book, Tough Choices, which she writes honestly about her triumphs and failures. Should be an interesting program. And just a reminder, the Churchill Club is also podcasting. So in the unlikely event that you can't make it to a program, you can still hear the podcast, and you can send it to friends. Visit our website for a list of podcasts, and you can subscribe under iTunes. And now, on to tonight's program. Guy Kawasaki brings over more than two decades of experience in the technology field as an original and irreverent strategist, starting as I think the first evangelist of the Macintosh. Second.
First to take credit.
That's a good marketing.
At Apple in the 80s, he led one of the great companies of the Valley, Apple, to their launch of the Macintosh, and turned ordinary consumers into evangelists. And as founder of CEO of Garage Technology Ventures, he's field-tested his ideas with dozens of newly hatched companies, and is also the author of multiple best-selling business books. So please join me in welcoming Guy Kawasaki and tonight's panelists.
Thank you. Thank you very much. Have I been the moderator 9 times? Is it? Really? God. That's scary. People were asking me, how many times did you do this, you know, moderate this panel? And I said, I think about 4. So, oh man, early onset Alzheimer's. So welcome to the evening tonight. We hope to shed some light on the state of startups in technology. The first thing I'd like to do is, when you go to these panels, most panels, they allow people at an extreme to use PowerPoint, and they each give panelist like 5 or 10 minutes to use PowerPoint. And I think that's just the stupidest thing in the world. For one thing, the most challenging part, I mean, it's stupid on many accounts because it wastes a lot of time. But the hardest part of that, which I've noticed, is if you're the panelist or the moderator, and you have to sit there and try to look interested for half an hour in other people's pitches, it's just so hard. And so that's why we don't do this, okay? So each of you have roughly 30 seconds to explain your name and your company and what you do. So we'll start over there with, maybe we should go by size of installed base, huh? How big is your installed base, Reed?
6.5 million.
Okay, so we'll start with Alex. So Alex, go ahead.
Yeah, I'm Alex Welch, the CEO and founder of photobucket.com. We're the leading photo and video sharing and publishing platform for bloggers, social networking, e-commerce sites. Currently have about 22 million members, doing about 15.5 million uniques per month.
How many of you use PhotoBucket? See, this crowd is too old.
How many of just a poll. How many have heard of Flickr? All right, there we go.
How many of you use Flickr? Wow.
So if we were in a mall and maybe in LA and there was a bunch of teenagers around, it would be flip-flops.
Well, who would you rather have? You know?
Trick question. No comment.
Okay, Daniel?
Yes, I'm Daniel. I'm the co-founder of ChaCha. We founded ChaCha 1 year ago. And what is ChaCha? ChaCha is a voice 2.0 service, actually. Probably the first one of this kind. And so you open up Charger, you type in your phone number, you type in the phone number of your friend, you hit the call button, your phone will ring, you start talking. No download, no installation, no headset, nothing. And you can do it worldwide, you know, just using your regular phone, no headset, and the rates are between free and cheap.
How many of you use Jaja in this audience? Wow, all right. And how many of you use Skype?
Okay.
We'll check again next year.
Next year again.
I'm going to ask, is it the same if you went to a mall in LA?
Okay, Joe?
I'm Joe Krause. I'm the CEO and co-founder of JotSpot. We're a hosted wiki company. Prior to this, back in the early 90s, started Excite.com, sold that in 99 to At Home, and I'm a proud board member of the Electronic Frontier Foundation. Yes.
How many of
I'm
you...
I'm coming to ask all of you for a donation later.
How many of you run a wiki or operate a wiki?
God, really? I love you all.
Wow. How many of you run a blog or... Okay. Reed?
So, show of hands, how many people are in LinkedIn?
Wow.
Okay. About six times, I think. Multiple.
How many people wish you weren't in LinkedIn?
You and I will talk afterwards.
See, you never pick a fight with the moderator.
Can I link to you, Guy?
but you know, I know a few people who will link to me through. You know, so come on, tell us more. I
mean, so LinkedIn is basically the leading online professional networking site. If you want to hire, reference check, find an end to a deal, find an expert. I mean, one way of looking at it. We have all these different angles, but if you think there's search for information, there's search for experts. It's one of the things you can do with LinkedIn. You all have some familiarity with it. You know, some of you are inactive, some of you are active. We're working on building out new features that will be, hopefully, make you all active.
All right. So. Lauren?
I'm Lauren Elliott, CEO and founder of a company called PNN, which is Personal News Network. We're effectively doing the desktop publishing application for all of those people who don't. It's sort of the democratization of publishing for the home and family market. For everybody in here who doesn't blog, have never read a blog, doesn't know what an RSS feed, has never read one, never started a website, we're at that market. And so we're trying to bring that kind of content, that kind of ability to the home and family market.
Okay, tell us about your Carmen Sandiego. I think that's a fascinating.
Well, I was, I guess, been in this business as long as Guy has. I started out by... we're working with the current Web 2.0 and 5.0, engineers, and these guys are all 21 years old. And the guy came in the other day that we've just hired. He's a Ruby on Rails programmer and all the latest Ajaxian stuff. And he comes up and he says, "I'm really pleased to meet you. I've loved the Carmen series. He says it's a true pleasure." And I thought, well, that's great. And then I realized he wasn't even born when I put the product out there. So I didn't know how to take it, but I was back in the early Brodeman days. I was their first designer. I was hired to work with all of the, when programmers came to Brodeman in those early 80s, they had done a game, but after that, they didn't know what to do. So Brodeman told me, I actually walked in with some sketches, and they said, well, if you can find a desk, convince my mother, because Gary Carlson's mother ran acquisitions, convince her that you deserve a light. She's got one in her room that you can have. And the programmers that if you can convince them of your ideas, you can stay. So I stayed for 13 years, designed 23 programs with them, and then left after that. So we designed six Carmen Sandiego series. The last one was We're in North Dakota. And I actually went to North Dakota and came back, and I'm sorry for all of you that live in North Dakota, but I couldn't find 100 facts that I could make into the program.
I have this housekeeping announcement. Is the owner of a Chrysler, which I guess I could say, the owner of a Mercedes-Benz, license 20C57, your car is double parked and is being towed. So you might want to get out there and rescue it.
Nobody's admitting it.
Nobody? How about we auction off the car?
They were in the car as it was being towed away.
All right, don't say I didn't warn you. So I'll start with you, Alex. I'll ask a series of questions, get everybody's quick answer just to like set the thing. First, how many people in the audience are entrepreneurs? And how many of you are, you know, trolling service providers looking to open up accounts? How many of you are venture capitalists? How many of you are venture capitalists with with the ability to invest tonight in companies? Nobody. Okay, so. All right, so Alex, I'll start with you. I would just like you to explain to the audience what each of your respective business models are. Not that, you know, business models matter in a Web 2.0 world, but go ahead, Alex.
Yeah, so with PhotoBucket, really the idea is to have a central place for you to put your stuff, whether it's images, photos, videos, other types of media to come. Really, people are wanting a central place to put everything. From that, they're taking the web and kind of building this full mesh out of it. They may have a blog and they're pulling in music, they're pulling in, you know, RSS feeds, they're pulling in images and videos. So really, you know, the average user links to many different places. They, you know, if you ask the teenage demographic, the word linking is becoming kind of a verb in their vocabulary. And, you know, they're wanting this simple place to store their content and really do what they want with their content. So the underlying business model was to grow a very large user base. It's primarily advertising today. We've got premium services, recently launched some mobile services, and really it's kind of a combination of you know, those couple different things to diversify the revenue model.
Okay. Daniel, what's your business model?
Well, we think in general that the telecommunication market is in transition. If you look to the past and you see that the prices for telecommunication, for telephony minutes, are constantly decreasing, and we will end up at zero rates sooner or later. What we are doing is we are taking this step for now, and we say, okay, we can now make free phone calls, and we will substitute this with additional services around telephony. So we will end up in a situation where we have the service voice 2.0. That means telephony will become a new experience, because currently telephony is stupid. You know, you type in a phone number, you call someone, you talk, you hang up. But you can do so much stuff around that. You can really create a great user experience. And everybody here is invited, you know, to have a look on Churchill.com, because we are constantly adding features around it. And these features are paid features. And we think that at the end of the day, these paid features, and also, you know, calling, for instance, expensive routes to cell phones in Europe and so on, will substitute this telephony.
So what is an example of an advanced feature that?
Yeah, I'll give you an example. So you remember last time when I was trying to call you, you picked up and said, hey, I don't have time. Call me in 2 hours.
Okay?
You know what I did? I took a post-it. Okay, I wrote it down and I forgot it. All of a sudden, you know. Then I took it again 3 hours later and you said, hey, I told you in 2 hours. Not in 3 hours. Please call me in 5 hours again. I'm rushing in a meeting, you know. Then I was scared, you know. And then I went to my Outlook, you know, and put in an appointment, you know, that it rings me. 5 hours later, it worked, you know. My Outlook rang, and I took the phone, and I called him. And this is stupid. You know, this is a waste of time. In Georgia, in this case, I would say, okay, this is a scheduled call. 2 hours, just a scheduled call. Guy Kawasaki. Set. And I'm done. 2 hours later, my phone will ring, and I will get connected. This is just one sample, you know, and there are tons of other possibilities what you can do.
Okay. Joe, JotSpot's business model?
We're a pretty straightforward, simple business model. We're a subscription-based service. So you can get a JotSpot account for free. You use it up to a certain level of system resources, how many users, how many pages, and then it's a subscription fee from there. We had a pricing philosophy that we call expensible, not approvable. I definitely believe that in any new technology, You want to convince the fewest number of people possible to buy it, and so we wanted it to be something you could put on a personal credit card and expense back, and then once your boss saw how cool and useful this stuff was, then you could subscribe at higher levels. So again, very straightforward, between 10 and 200 bucks a month.
So your target market are people who work for companies to create a corporate wiki that...
Yeah, we primarily target the small to mid-sized business market, although we have some emerging products into the larger enterprise. The great thing about the SMB market is that they have all of the collaborative challenges of larger companies, but none of the people and the money. And so hosted services are perfect for that community. They're also willing to put stuff on personal credit cards as opposed to dealing with invoices, so the billing system is much easier in terms of recurring billing.
Okay. Reed?
So LinkedIn is about connecting the right professional you need, whether it's, you know, an expert, someone you'll hire, reference check, BD deal. We have hedge funds that use those in order to do market research. Three revenue lines, subscriptions, which allows you to kind of directly connect with people through an internal reputation-based system called InMail. Job listings, hiring through your network, usually gets you much better results, and advertising. And we're profitable.
You are?
Yep.
Really?
Yeah.
Mazel tov, as
Snaps
we say.
Snaps for Reed.
Okay, Laura?
We're a subscription and premium service-based company, and that line I've spent the last month doing the VC route, and I've said that about 400 times. Really, what we are is publishing for the home and family market, and it's an ad-driven model, so that there are personalized ads put in it. I think I read somewhere that the last newspaper is going to be printed in 2032 or 2010, and we hope that PNN is the equivalent to that. It's basically turning everybody into editors. We add the ad content. We're sharing revenues back with the users. So that's okay. What we do.
Daniel, I'll start with you. Come back down and go back to Alex now. You know, there's not a lot of liquidity right now in terms of IPO, and I don't think that every company can assume they're going to be bought by Google or Yahoo or, you know, whatever, or Rupert. And so how are you retaining and hiring employees? I mean, are they trying to get more regular income and less options? Are they still they're willing to take flyers and get a lot of options, take a cut in pay? How are you guys motivating and hiring employees in an illiquid market?
First of all, you have to differentiate. So we have employees in Israel, R&D team, and we have employees in the US and in Europe. And in each of these countries, you have different situations. So in Israel, for instance, everybody works for options. They don't care about their monthly salary as long as they survive. In Europe, the situation is different because, in my point of view, the whole IT industry is not as developed as it is here. So they really want to have monthly salaries, good big salaries. They don't care about options. And what we're seeing here is, the monthly salaries are a little bit higher, you know, compared to Israel, for instance. But still, everybody believes, you know, in startups, and everybody wants stock options, even with this 409 stuff. But in my point of view, in my experience, it's extremely positive here, getting people motivated with stock options.
Okay.
So my general view here is that Americans as a whole, and certainly Silicon Valley in particular, we're all optimists. And there was a great poll done by CNN during the 2000 election, and it asked the question, are you in the top 1% of earners in this country? 19% said yes. And above and beyond that, another 20% said I will be someday. So a full 39% of us believe we will someday or are today in the top 1% of earners in this country. I bet if you did that poll in Silicon Valley in terms of what percentages of your startups will succeed, the answer would be something extraordinary, like, you know, 80%. But in reality, it's going to be, you know, less than 5%. So the truth is that we have a very inherently motivated workforce, I think, just because of the legend of Silicon Valley. And because every one of us believes when a flicker gets acquired that we're next. So I would say generally the myth is alive and well. Most companies, of course, will fail, but that doesn't hurt the general motivation. I will say that, number one, we have definitely seen a higher sensitivity towards salary and less expectations on the options front in general. certainly compared to when we were starting Excite. The second thing is some intangibles with regard to motivation. We do something at JotSpot we call a hackathon. And the idea is for the developer crew is to basically say, hey, we're going to make an event, and it's going to be a 1 or 2 day event where we basically, you know, I am basically the guy who brings food for everybody and wears a stupid hat and blows an air horn to start the thing off. But it's an engineering competition event internally that we do, I don't know, now once a quarter to once every 6 months. And basically everybody secretly works on a project for about a day or two. And then 6 p.m. on the final night, we have presentations where everybody's showing their stuff. And it's amazing. So little things with regard to morale and motivation, I think, that make a difference. But we're definitely seeing increased sensitivity on cash.
What if you're a marketing person? What do you do at your hackathon thing?
We haven't had a hackathon since we've built out that part of the organization. So I don't know. Maybe they'll
show up with their PowerPoint slides.
Well, Zach, we're going to follow your 10-20-30 rule.
All right. Okay, Reed, what are you doing?
Very largely the same as Joe. I generally am seeing that, I mean, Valley's got more expensive to live, so that has also raised salaries. There's also some large companies doing a lot of aggressive hiring, which means that you have to somewhat match against them. But generally speaking, most, I think, of the employees kind of calibrate to kind of a sustenance level, but a Silicon Valley sustenance level, and then options. But you also find that you have to do a lot of intangibles. So we use the former Google chef to cater food, you know, 5 days a week for lunch. We have a Guitar Hero little video thing.
Why is he former Google? Is he like a billionaire and he does it on the side?
He might, actually. I have no idea. It's just, it's actually a really convenient thing.
He's got all these white people working for him?
Yeah, maybe. Well, you get a lot of healthy salads, so instead of having like Kit Kat bars and whatnot, you've got salads and so on. Anyway, basically the same.
Okay, Laura?
Well, we're different than the other companies here. We're a startup that's just, we have 6 employees or 6 or 8. We're up in Sonoma County, so we're not down here. The couple engineers, one is in Seattle, one is in Houston. I actually just hope they don't hear this conversation that everything else is going on. Because I think, you know, they've been working about a year. They're all contract basis. They've been working for probably half of what their normal salaries are. Every one of the company, a fellow that Richard Luther hears tonight, he is our manager and IT guy. They have, for some reason, enjoyed the camaraderie of everybody else. It's kind of back to the old early software days. They like what they're doing. Everybody gets to contribute to the project. It's one of those old days. There's no perks. It's a warehouse with no air conditioning, no heating. There are no outdoor windows.
Sign me up.
That's what I'm saying. I hope they don't hear any of this.
No venture capitalists to deal with.
There's nothing to deal with. I'm the only guy there that they can. They have their own schedules, but they all work more hours.
How many of you would trade places with him?
So that's it.
Okay. I'll start with you, Joe, on this one. Generally speaking, you know, clearly you've been through the dot-com irrational exuberance, the dot-com implosion, irrational depression. What would you characterize the current state of entrepreneurship and startups in Silicon Valley? What, you know, are we between those two extremes? Are we?
Well, I guess I would say a few things. One is that I think we're at a time of immense cheap innovation. It's cheaper than ever before to build a product. And I think a lot of people conflate that with it's cheaper than ever before to start a company, which I think are two very different things. But it's cheaper than ever before to build a product. And that's a result of a whole lot of factors, from cheap hardware to offshore labor to free open source software to AdWords. And I think that results in a lot more funders because it's so much cheaper. So the funding base for products and entrepreneurs has increased pretty radically, which means that you got a lot more things that are being funded that can be brought to market and succeed or fail. So I think for any one particular startup, I think that the chances of survival are low, but I think in general the benefit of all of this cheap innovation is going to be really good for the market in general. I think there's... somebody said this to me, Mobius Venture Capital, Bill, anybody help me here? Bill
Burnett,
thank you. Have you heard his definition of Web 2.0? I thought it was a great one. It was Web 2.0 for him is Ajax, AdSense, and Arrogance. And so I think that there is creeping in a little bit this sense of, it's definitely not entitlement like I felt it was in the late 90s. I remember interviewing people at Excite right out of business school, and the expectations those people had were a little bit stomach turning. But there's definitely a entitlement, again, entitlement's the wrong word, but definitely a really high confidence that their company in particular is going to make it and have a successful exit. So I would say that what I like about it is that there feels like a return to entrepreneurship and a return for doing it for the love of it, which feels great. At the same time, I do think there's an irrational optimism about how many, but that comes from that whole CNN poll, about how many are going to make it. And that can, that confidence can a little bit tinge, I think, on the border of arrogance at times.
Okay, Reed?
I think this will be a different angle on some of the things Joe just said, which is I think there's a lot of very good innovation. I mean, the area that I most focus on is consumer internet. And while there is a huge number of companies started, and one of the downsides is people don't think sufficiently about how is it really differentiated. You're seeing a little bit of the, you know, throw together a couple buzzwords, you know, Ajax, right, other kinds of things. And then it's like, oh, it's different just this way, but, you know, it'll be great. And that doesn't really work. But on the other hand, I actually think that, you know, 5 to 7 years from now, we will see another major company emerge, you know, somewhere between, you know, Amazon and Google in terms of size in some different area. It's likely to be one that none of us will have picked right now, because I actually think that if you look at the trends in terms of how people are consuming media, you know, newspaper circulation goes down year by year, television doesn't reach young audiences, and more of people's lives are moving online. If you actually think about how much you have, how much goes on in your life, and as yet still how little of it is facilitated by online, I think there's still a lot of room for it. So the trend is, you know, don't just kind of do a Me Too, you know, buzzword bingo startup, but I actually think there's a lot of opportunity for the next 10 or 20 years.
Can I have one thing?
Sure.
I think one of the big differences in this case is that if the whole thing does explode, the people who get hurt are a very different class of people that get hurt, right? I mean, there is no ability for retail investors to invest in this latest boom. It's all private equity. So the whole thing goes down in flames. It's lost by people that can, are either professional investors or can afford to lose it. So,
well, but what if you're investing CalPERS money?
Oh, you know, they have enough diversity that presumably they have very smart people doing portfolio
teachers
balancing.
Teachers don't have that big houses and stuff. Okay? Laura?
Well,
you can compare us to, you know, back in the 70s. Yeah,
well, that's true.
Man.
70s, Jesus.
1970s.
80s.
Oh, brutal.
I mind is full of witty remarks, but I won't pick one on them. I mean, it is true. I think from my mind is a little different. I think that the enthusiasm I see, I mean, one of the reasons I got out of the software industry was that it had turned into a publishing market. In the early days, it was very definitely, I mean, entrepreneurially, I suppose, in that sense, but it was, I mean, any kid could do a software program and get it out to market, you know, without money. And I, at the end of this the software industry days, what I think is the end of it was that, you know, the market, last project I worked on were, you know, millions of dollars in 2 years in development and everything else in focus groups and you know, rooms full of people with claiming to have knowledge of everything. And the internet's fun. The guys I'm working with have a tremendous interest in all of that. There is no, I mean, Jesus, these guys are 20-some years old. I mean, there's... To them, the internet is unformed. I mean, to them, it is nothing but opportunity. I mean, the kinds of things that we've seen in the last few years are incredible. I mean, and that same sort of poll things that, you know, 80% of the people that were online yesterday that I just mentioned that haven't done blogs, haven't heard of RSS or any, have got cell phone cameras. That the stat is that people buy cell phones because they have the potential to take pictures. 50% of the, no, it's... it's something like 80% of the people that have never sent a picture to anyone. Now, what, you know, that's because there's no reason, they can't think of a reason for it. So all that Alex was talking about, all of this content, all of the all the content that's coming to the web is truly exciting. And I think the ideas and the new companies and the users, I think it's going to be incredibly spectacular in the next five, probably less than 5 years.
How many of you have cell phones with cameras? Basically everybody, right? So how many of you have never sent a photo from your camera? Yeah, me too. I've never. Huh. Okay, Alex, what's your assessment of...
So I moved out here from Denver about a year ago, and a company I started about 3 years ago. And, you know, for me personally, it's quite a change. I think that, you know, in Denver, you know, we yanked a lot of our employees from our last job, and I think in 99, 2000, our first stock option grant was something like 10 or 11 options. And, you know, so you can attract people, you can get them, and, you know, a lot of us were stuck in, you know, the Denver telecom jobs, at least a lot of the engineers at PhotoBucket, and, you know, we really are really passionate about what we do, and we look at the world as, you know, let's just simplify the way that you do things. I think that, you know, a lot of companies get so tied up in how do we innovate, how do we have the perfect differentiator. We step back and say, what does the mainstream really want? What are the drop-dead simple things you can give them and keep it reliable, keep it safe? And they tend to be pretty happy. You don't have to always have, you know, the most bleeding edge technology. So for us, you know, we really think that there's huge opportunity in solving problems for the masses, and that's kind of how we look at it.
All right, Daniel?
I mean, we are a pretty young company, 6 months on air, but my personal opinion is that two things. A, the web has grown up somehow, so that means users are now willing to pay for good services. And compared, you know, to 10 years, to the bubble, to the first bubble, everybody expected everybody's free. Everything is free. So this has changed. And the second thing is, in my point of view, that now entrepreneurs are really thinking about sustainable business models. I mean, if you have looked into this business models during the bubble, the whole business plans, they were based on raising money all the time. And then it crashed, and the companies filed for bankruptcy. And this has changed significantly, I guess. So for instance, we will be profitable this year. And LinkedIn is profitable already. So we are talking about real economy here, real business. And these are the two things which have changed. So these are my two cents.
OK. I think, Reed, it's your turn to start. Yeah. We have an audience primarily of entrepreneurs, so if you could just give them, you know, your top one, two, maybe three tips about starting a company that, you know, you learned the hard way or the easy way.
Let's see. Okay, so two or three things. First thing is actually take your idea. There's a tendency to be very closeted because you think that, you know, you've got this unique idea that no one else has thought of, and by being secretive about it, you'll get kind of an avenue to market. At least go to, you know, 3 to 5 of the smartest, insightful people you know and get them to critique your idea, because frequently, about at least half the time, you can find what the serious problem is. And you should give some serious thought to whether or not that's an overcomable thing. I mean, one of the things I most often see in early entrepreneurial things is they say, well, I've got this idea. And you're like, well, yeah, but the problem is you have to get 10 million users into your system before it starts getting useful at all, right? And if that much of a ramp, you have a problem, right, or something like that. So give serious thought to whether or not actually, I'll give you a personal example of that, which is in 97, I founded a company called SocialNet, one of the key components to dating service, and as it turned out, the very first serious objection that was raised turned out to be very true of the business, which is the problem is your customers churn at 3.5 months. They're done with you for one of two reasons. Either you found somebody, and then they're happy, and they're gone, right? Or they haven't found someone, and they're unhappy, and they're gone. And so it really limits the effectiveness of how much you can do that. And you know, we were 2.5 years later struggling with this issue that surfaced in the first intelligent discussion of it. Second thing is, at least as far as consumer internet stuff goes, which is, you know, I understand better than other things. The frequently when an entrepreneur comes to me and says, I have this really killer consumer internet idea, I basically say, tell me your distribution plan. How is it you get to your first 1 million users? Because that's what the consumer internet's about. You know, in retail, you say the three words of retail, location, location, location. In consumer internet, it's distribution, distribution, distribution. I'm not even interested in anything else until I'm basically told that piece of it. And I'm surprised still at how many times I see people trying to do consumer internet stuff where they come up and say, oh, we'll solve distribution later. And you're like, well, zero distribution means zero value, period. No, it doesn't matter all the rest of the IP. Oh, we'll have patents. And we'll have a really complex technical system. It's like, yeah, fine. Right? Doesn't matter. And then the third thing is, to think about, I guess this piece of advice. One of the ways that I try to emphasize the value of time and time to market is if you're not embarrassed in the consumer internet by the first version of the product you launch, you've launched too late.
That's the Vista test. Yeah. Daniel, I couldn't resist. I knew you were there. That's a very interesting algorithm. There's a book in there somewhere. Absolutely. But I have to have a follow-on question for you, which is, so one of your things was ask six smart people, okay? But you know, you can look through history and see that lots of times smart people said very stupid things, like, does the world need another search engine to Google? You know, what's a router to Cisco? No one wants a personal computer. They have a mini computer to Apple. And, you know, seemingly smart people. I turned on the opportunity to interview for CEO position of Yahoo. That's why I got to do these free moderating panel things. So, now, granted, I'm assuming you think I'm smart. But, so how do you know who to ask? Maybe a better algorithm is you ask six smart people and you do the opposite of what they say.
Well, I think you take their opinion under advisement. You don't always follow it. There are risks that you roll the dice on. But part of it is there's a tendency to try not to get really critical feedback and then think about it.
To not get really critical.
Well, because you're visualizing success. I mean, entrepreneurs are almost categorically insane, right? They look at this, and there's like a blank sheet. Right. And they're like, I see a castle. There's a castle here. I'll just build it, right? And it's not there. And frequently, you know, 5%, whatever, doesn't get to be there. And you have to be insane that way, right? Because you always will have some things you go, I think that'll break my way and that'll work, right? But to think pretty seriously about it, because more or less, I we'll see how well I, you know, end up choosing which companies I invest in and whatnot. But I have generally been felt that, you know, over the last few years when I've been looking at consumer internet stuff, some of the basic tenets are just almost always true, right? So like, does this have a real good distribution model? Is it something that will spread on the web? Is this just one of 50,000 things that are happening? Is there an economic model here that actually, in fact, people will pay for? Those kinds of questions. And it just, I think it's possible to, it's not 100% prediction, and frequently, the contrarian standpoint, you know, the biggest ideas are when everyone thinks you're insane and you were right. Right? Of course,
that's descriptive, not predictive.
Yes, exactly. That's in retrospect because there were a lot of other ones that didn't go anywhere. So it's don't value speed and value intelligent feedback over secrecy.
Okay. So okay, Lauren, your tips.
A little bit different position again because I do, projects that take a number of years to get going, and so I don't, think about it too much. I mean, I think the current, the web applications that we're doing, sort of by their nature, are always they're sort of interactive from the get-go. At least the ones I'm doing. I mean, they're kind of home and family market products, and so my family is, they're, as I think I've said too often in front of her, and, she's a Luddite. And I've been happily married for 20 years, and she always wonders what I do during the day. But so if I can convince her, and I can show her, and she says, "Oh, that's okay, that's cool," and I do this to all of our team members all do it to their families. But it's so we so it's very interactive. I agree that it's not secret. I've never worried about being secret about products. I've just never occurs to me, and I don't know that that's good or bad, but it doesn't. On the other hand, I think there is a point. In the last month, we've been doing the Silicon Valley route, and I think we have, I think, approached it, and I think with help from a couple of advisors, Larry Birkin is here, he's one of our advisors. He said, you know, you go to these guys and be absolutely open to them, and you just tell them everything you know about it, everything you believe about it, and then listen, you know, shut up and listen. And we've done that, and it's been very helpful. It really has been. I think there's a experience. I mean, these guys have, I mean, all the companies, they've all got scars on their backs from the companies they have, you know, successfully or not successfully done. And I think there's a story to listen to in every one of these people, and hints from this panel and everything else. And so all I can say is access to as many people, and then you have to make up your own mind about it later on. But okay. It's been very helpful.
Alex, tips?
I think, you know, when I started PhotoBucket, it was really kind of stepping back and say, what is something that I really need? I think you have to have really true passion about your product. I think it's really, really important to take that idea and quickly start iterating on it. I see, you know, so many companies that, or so many individuals that have great ideas, and you know, they'll sit there and iterate and try to make it really perfect. I think, you know, nothing's perfect no matter what you do. It's not going to be perfect definitely on the first time. And get it out there in the market and just really listen to what people are saying about it. In the beginning, you know, people were telling us exactly what they thought, exactly what they wanted. You listen to that, and, you know, we drive north of 50% of our roadmap based on just peer feedback in the suggestion box. And, you know, they're generally really happy if you continue to give them what they are asking for. I think staying really, really focused on a few core things. So many people look at problems and they say, oh, there's a great way to solve it, and then another problem comes up and they have 10 ways to solve that. At the end of the day, you know, if you're passionate about what you do and it's something that fills a basic need, keep it really simple. You know, a lot of people ask, what's the secret sauce in PhotoBucket? I said, look at PhotoBucket, look at YouTube, look at MySpace. There was many, many, many companies that did very, very similar things. For some reason, a few of us have just nailed one little piece of that. You can't nail everything. I look at Google, and they nailed that little search piece at the very beginning, and that allows you to grow and really do more as you grow and you get distribution. But I think just really keep focused on the simple things that people want.
So with hindsight, what was the equivalent of the Google search box or PhotoBucket? What was the thing that... Yeah, that allows you to have 20.5 MySpaces.
So it was the 80 lines of code that ran the entire thing without a database. It was just a simple web form that allowed you to upload a piece of content and gave you back a URL. That was all there was to it. And you know, you build on that, but you don't have to have, you know, five steps to get a piece of content from your computer to, you know, to the internet, and then to share that. So, again, keeping it simple, one page.
Okay, Daniel?
Yeah, well, we have heard a lot about product and how we should look at the product before. My input in terms of product is make it as simple as possible, show it to your wife. And if it is not working, throw it in the bin. And the second input is in terms of getting VCs on board, right? And this is also important. You need money, actually, to really drive your project. And my tip here is start communicating with your favorite VCs at the very first beginning, even if you're not looking for money, actually. Start communicating with them. Go to them, say, this is my idea. What's your opinion? You know, build your network. Get their inputs. I mean, they are professionals. And when it comes to a stage where you need money then, you already have your network, they know you, and then it's much, much easier to get real good conditions and get venture money.
Can you tell the audience the story of how Sequoia found you?
Well, actually, Charger was the first investment from Sequoia outside the US in Europe. And Michael Moritz left his train, his aeroplane, and he spoke with a friend and he said, hey, have you heard about this Charger, this Australian stuff? Yeah, from Austria, but he's not Australia. And by the way, so
spelling is close.
It's close. It's so they talked to each other and said, "Okay, I will send a scout. You know, let's figure out who this charger guy is, what they are doing in reality." And so they watched out for charger in Australia. They didn't find us. We were worried, you know, and then they had the idea, okay, what about the charger domain? Let's do a WHOIS search. And they found me in Vienna, and then they said to their Israeli partner, hey, Austria is next to Israel. Just jump in your car, drive to Austria and have a look, right? So he said, well, it's 3-4 hours flight. It's not, we cannot do it with a car, but I will fly over. And so they wrote us an email, and basically they found us. And they flew in, and 21 days later, everything was signed. 7 days later, the money was in the account. The company was closed in Austria. We moved everything to the Silicon Valley, and here we are.
Well, don't everybody think that's how it happens, okay? Not everybody's Wayne Gretzky either. Okay, Joe, your tips?
I have three, and I apologize if anybody's heard me tell some of these stories before, but I think they're illustrative of the points. I think the first biggest key to success is just straight up old-fashioned persistence. That the beginning of the discussion is when somebody says no. That's where the fun begins. And an example of this from way, way back in my career was in the early days of Netscape and Excite, where in the 1995, I think, Netscape decided to put two of, speaking to Reed's point of distribution, two buttons on the Chrome of the browser up for bid. One said net search, one said net directory. And there were three bidders for those two spots. It was us, InfoSeek, and MCI. We had $1 million in the bank, and we all got together in a room and decided what were we gonna bid. And Vinod Khosla, who was on our board at the time, suddenly goes, $3 million. And I'm like, Vinod, we have $1 million in the bank. How are we going to bid $3 million? He's like, oh, we'll figure that out. So we bid $3 million. Actually, his point was a good one. His point was, if you win, it's a bankable deal. If you lose, you're kind of screwed. So you're going to want to bid as much as you can. So we bid. We lost. And we were devastated. But we didn't give up. We actually kept acting as if the negotiation wasn't over. We sat in Netscape's lobby unannounced. We kept calling Mike Homer. I'm sure still to this day he's pissed off that we called him all the time. Demanded meetings, talked to the CEO. Again, sat just sitting in their lobby like, we'd like a meeting, we'd like a meeting, we'd like a meeting. And 21 days later, MCI had a hiccup. They couldn't deliver their product, and we got the deal back. And it's that reason that Excite succeeded. That one deal made Excite, put Excite on its trajectory, and it's because we didn't give up. And I have example after example after example of when a recruit says, no, I'm not coming to your company, get on a plane. Like, never taking no for an answer is huge. Second thing I would say, opportunity creates opportunity in ways that you cannot predict at all. A good example of this, how did Excite get funding? The chain of events in retrospect is ridiculous, but you never knew from one step to the other how it was going to happen. 1993, when I graduated from Stanford, I got a book from a girlfriend at the time, Accidental Empires. It was a gossip history of Silicon Valley. Great book. And in it, the author says, tips for entrepreneurs, call me, I'm a cheap date. So my nickname at the time when we were starting the company was Phone Boy. My job was to call. I circled names in the Wall Street Journal and just cold called all the time and tried to talk to people about what we were doing. So I called him, and we had lunch, and he said, oh, I'd be really interested in joining the company. Now, I thought a prominent author joining our company was suddenly we were successful. So I was really excited. But it turns out he didn't join the company, but he did introduce us to the magazine he wrote for, InfoWorld. InfoWorld said, hey, you know, we have all these archives of our magazine. Why don't you put those on the web? And if you do a good job, we'll pay you a contract fee for that first $100,000 contract. If you do a good job, we'll introduce you to our parent company, IDG. We did a good job. They introduced us to IDG. We went to their board and said, would you fund the company? Well, they weren't particularly interested, but there was a man on that board named Steve Coit out in Boston, Charles River Ventures. He said, yeah, this kind of looks interesting. Let me introduce you to Jeff Yang over at what was then IVP, now Redpoint. Jeff wasn't interested necessarily, but he did introduce us to Vinod Khosla. And we had a very interesting meeting with Vinod, where normally in the first 5 minutes we were asked, how are you going to make money? Vinod's first question was, well, how does this technology scale? We said, we don't know. We can't afford a hard drive that's big enough to test if this stuff scales. And so he pulls out his giant phone at the time, orders us a $10,000 hard drive, which, by the way, was 10 gigabytes. and we got funding from Vinod without a business plan. So from a book that my girlfriend bought me and a call that I made to a series of events which led to Excite being funded without a business plan for $3 million, you could never predict how those things are going to happen. And it happens all the time in business.
Is she your wife now?
No.
So what you... Well, hopefully you took care of her somehow.
Well...
Did you buy her a Prius or something?
You have no idea, Guy.
You paid in other ways?
You don't want to go there, my friend.
That's why you can't walk.
It'll become a therapy session. You don't want that. These good people don't want that. I see it all the time in business, you know, and it's especially difficult, I think, sometimes with, I don't mean to blanket a group of people, but we have great engineers at our company, but at times I don't think they understand how one opportunity leads to another, and sometimes the thing that they're working on won't pay off, but you never know how that leads to something else. The third thing I would say is hiring. It sounds so simple. There is a culture, I think, in Silicon Valley, which is hire fast, fire fast. Well, you know, I need people right away, got to hire them right now. It's key to our business plan. And we did it at Excite, and I don't believe in it anymore. I mean, we hire so slowly at JotSpot, but we have a philosophy that we call no false positives. We'll reject tons of people that probably would work out okay, but we smell something funny. In order to guarantee, we'll throw lots of false negatives in order to guarantee we never get a false positive, that everybody who walks in the door is going to be amazing and going to be successful. And it sounds crazy, but the reason great people come to work at your company is because there are other great people at your company. So the instant you let your guard down, you're suddenly decreasing the level of your talent. And I guess I'd say the fourth thing is, it was like what Reed was mentioning with regard to getting this feedback. Admiral James Stockdale, I don't know how many people know the story of James Stockdale, but he was the longest prisoner of war, I believe, in Vietnam. And he endured amazing hardships. And when asked, like, how did you survive for, I don't know how long it was, 6 years, 7 years in a prisoner of war camp? And the answer was, well, the question, the way I've heard the story told is the questioner said, well, were you an optimist? And he said, no, the optimist died. The optimist believed that they would get out. You know, they got in at Christmas. They said, I'd be out by Easter. Easter would come. Easter would go. They wouldn't get out. They'd say, I'd be out by December. December would come. December would go. They wouldn't get out, and they died. And so I'm telling the story terribly. Stockdale originally says, this is terrible, I never doubted for a moment that this would be the most defining positive experience of my entire life. So the person said, you must be an optimist. He said, no, the optimist died. I think there's a Stockdale paradox for startups, which is that you can never stop believing that what you are doing is going to be the most successful thing you can make it. But every day you have to face the hard, cold reality of what's right in front of you. And you can't let your sense of optimism force you into denial about the facts on the ground. And so I write in every kind of notebook that I have, I write the words face reality when I start a new notebook, because I think there's a delusional tendency that we all have as entrepreneurs to want to believe that we can make the world a certain way. And that's what makes entrepreneurship great, but it's also the risk we face day to day. That was way too long.
That's okay. I want to follow on position on a question on persistence. Now, at some point, surely some people are persisting stupid things. So, I mean, you know, it's great to tell this story about how you persisted and you got all this stuff, but, you know, the odds are that sometimes you're pursuing the wrong thing. So how do you know if you're giving up too soon or...
You don't know, right? I don't think it invalidates the notion that persistence is what I feel, at least, is the key to success, despite the fact that I probably persist a lot of dumb things. It's the few things that you persisted that would have been denied you that you got right that are the swing factors for the company.
Okay. I also have a story for you about this Vinod story, and it has to do with Alex, and it doesn't quite have a happy ending, but it's a good story anyway. So I know this person in Vancouver, and he loves Breitling watches, as I do. I love Breitling watches. So he sent me a picture of this Breitling watch one day, and it was a link, and I click on it, and it takes me to PhotoBucket. And at the time, this was the only site that stored photos that when I got there, I didn't have to register, I didn't have to sign in, I didn't have to do anything. It just took me right to the picture. And so I had that experience. I said, my God, this is a very interesting company. I mean, for once, I don't have to fill out 65 fields of information to just view the freaking Breitling picture, right? And so then I did a who is, and I got Alex's email. And then I sent him this email saying, I really think this is interesting.
You're
and then,
a spammer, aren't you?
No. I'm focused marketing. And then he responded, and it was this like whole Guy Kawasaki, I read your book, when I was in elementary school, I read your first book. My father talks about you, my grandfather worked with you, the whole thing. And so then I flew to Denver, and then I met with them. And the bad part about all this is we have a conflict in what I thought was a conflict in our portfolio. So when he asked if we wanted to invest, I couldn't invest. And I've been kicking myself ever since this. So, but the good story is, Breitling watches led me to Alex. So that's, I don't know what you make of that. I don't know. Everybody go out and buy a Breitling. But.
Well, and Guy probably doesn't remember. I had met Guy probably about, a year before we formally met. He was out in Denver giving a presentation and on the art of the start. And I got a signed book from Guy. And My partner and I, we worked out of his basement. And it was really the two guys in a garage type thing. And we went to this, and we were kind of tossing the idea around of raising money. And we got inspired by a guy. He was out there speaking, and then going to college hockey games. But it was really interesting because at the time I had thought about raising money. I called a couple VCs here in the Valley, and everybody just blew us off. So we got third mortgages and really kind of funded the thing ourselves. But, it was really interesting just to walk through that experience. And if you haven't read The Art of the Start, I would say that there's some really, really good points in there, because that was really where I got, some of the ideas that I had. And
so if you're feeling so beholden to me, how about letting me in now? I'll take the last evaluation. Okay, so I think that I have dominated the questions long enough, and I will take, we have a mic runner or somebody like that. Let's take some questions from the audience. So who's got the mic? There's the mic right over here.
So this question is perhaps at Joe and Reed. So whenever you start something at the beginning of the startup, you have a thesis. And the thesis is that we are going to do, this is the problem we are trying to solve. This is the expected behavior of the customers we are going to get, and hence this is going to lead to economic success. And usually once you have gotten down that path, there are surprises, okay? And some pleasant ones and some unpleasant ones. So since both of you have had consumer-focused companies which have been around for some time, could you just perhaps enlighten us on a couple of things which were surprising to you as you started these things?
I need time to think, so you got to go first.
So when PayPal, which I was on the board of the time, launched, the heavy focus was around mobile payments. And the thought was that like Palm Pilots and other kinds of things would be used. And the very first week, noticed this takeoff of traffic on eBay. And I remember the first few discussions, everyone rewrites the history of, oh, we were planning that.
Yeah.
And you always, everything is a triumphal march that was planned from the beginning.
We planned desktop publishing at Apple.
Yes, exactly. And I remember the first 3 days of, do we want this? Do we want to allow this to happen? This isn't what we're trying to do. Then wait a minute. Customers are using it. Oh, this is good. And for example, one of the things it's kind of the focus is about 9 months later, despite the fact that we had been put on the Palm website and everything else because we were doing the Palm, we just shut down the Palm product altogether because the Palm grew like this, maybe five more transactions per week, right? And the eBay and the website grew like this. And we're like, we don't want to do the development drag for that. And so what was, in fact, what we spent 9 months of, 1999 debating on the board level about like, well, how are we going to do this mobile thing and how are we going to get people to split the bill at restaurants and everything else, basically started going out the door the second week after the launch, right? And within about 2 months after the launch, it was, yeah, we have this Palm thing too. Hey, could someone negotiate with Palm and see if we can get some traffic or something? Right. And then we just looked at it and we went, okay, focus is very important in startups. And we went, well, look, the fact we have anyone thinking about this is bad. We're just going to shut it down. And actually, the funniest little knock-on punch to that was Peter, who's the CEO, came to me and said, look, if you can't get someone on Palm to do something, we're just going to shut it down. And I said, fine. Because I was part of that decision too. And I called, tried to get someone to respond to my phone call, Palm. And I said, look, we're going to shut this down. No one returned my phone call. We shut it down. And the next day, the phones kept ringing from Palm the whole day. And you're like, well, we tried to reach you. Anyway, so that's an instance.
Any other thoughts?
I guess what I would I have, unfortunately, a little bit of a general answer as opposed to a specific one. But I'm always wary of anybody that divides the world into two camps, but I'm about to do it. I really think there are two kinds of entrepreneurs. I think there's top-down entrepreneurs and bottom-up entrepreneurs. So a top-down entrepreneur basically looks at where there's an established business model, potentially an established habit, and tries to find a niche. So I would argue today if you're a vertical search company, you're probably more a top-down entrepreneur than a bottom-up entrepreneur. Search is a well-established business model. The risk is primarily in execution. I'm not that. I'm not good at that way of thinking for whatever reason. And which means that the premise of your question was that you have a lot of predictions about what people will do. I tend not to have that ability. I don't predict well. I'm much more the bottom-up entrepreneur. I think a bottom-up entrepreneur looks for patterns that feel familiar. And I'll take JotSpot as an example. When we were looking at wikis 3 years ago, we felt like it was the internet in 1993. Here was this very useful, broadly applicable technology trapped in the land of the nerds. Felt like, Archie, Veronica, Gopher, and Waze. And that smelled right. Then you went across to companies in Silicon Valley, asked the CEO, do you have a wiki? No. You go down to their product manager, do you have a wiki? Oh, yeah, we got like three or four. We'd never get rid of them. Those were two patterns that felt familiar. And my kind of motto for bottom-up entrepreneurship is that it's better to be a trend spotter than a trend setter. Another statement is that being early is the same as being wrong in a startup. It feels the same. Your market isn't there, which is why I think being a trend spotter, not a trend setter, is the right thing. Find something that's moving and attach yourself to it. You have to guess less about how people will actually react.
Okay. Next question.
Well, you're all clearly very successful. So if you look back on your life and you could spend a little more time doing one thing that you maybe didn't do as much of as you would have liked, what would that thing be? What do you wish you had done more of?
Okay. What do you wish you'd done more of?
Sleep.
We hear sleep. What do you have, Lauren?
Play more hockey, actually. I've lost that skill. Yeah, okay. More recreation.
At least you had something to lose. Joe? Joe's still thinking about his girlfriend.
You saved me, man. That was good. I don't know. I feel tremendously... I don't have a quick answer. I don't have an easy answer. I feel like I'm one of the luckiest guys around. So I don't... I wish a site hadn't gone out of business. Definitely.
Okay. Daniel?
Simply the same.
Alex?
You know,
I don't know. I feel extremely lucky as well. I feel this is my first run at this, and now I'm hoping to do it again and again and again. But I think, you know, probably spending a little more time really coding. That was kind of my passion. I came out here, and now you spend half your day dealing with people, and, you know, it's just, I wish I would have spent more time coding.
Oh, those pesky little employees, yeah. Okay, over here. It's coming to you.
I hate to follow that question. It sounded like it had such finality to it. Reed, you mentioned that distribution was key to any one of these startups, and that was really the thing you look for. Mm-hmm. It'd be interesting to hear each of you talk a little about what constitutes that first set of customers, meaning how big do you need for critical mass, and what is your distribution plan to achieve that, or okay. was in some cases?
Good question. Alex?
So we, you know, it's a consumer internet company that's, you know, kind of gotten that viral marketing phenomenon that happens. And once you have that, you just have to continue to feed it and, you know, get people excited about your product. And I think that, you know, they tend to tell other people about it and, you know, just really fuel that and stay focused on that. And it's allowed us to continue to grow at 80,000 new users every day, and we've have zero marketing budget. So
you never really had someone distributing you, right? People found you. And
people found us, yeah. And then got into this.
And you don't have some great story about, you know, sitting in Netscape's lobby or your search engine optimization expert or nothing?
No.
How did Trixie and Biff find you?
I think, you know, people just started figuring out that they would right-click on pictures and say, well, how do I do that? And it was the early eBayers, the early bloggers, and they just started telling their friends. It's a great thing.
Okay. Daniel?
In charge, it's a combination, you know, of viral marketing and classical marketing. So the viral engine is that only calls between charger users, they have to register, are free. And we also faced a lot of press attention because of this first Sequoia investment in Europe and so on. And basically, if you have such a famous VC, you get a lot of attention. And we keep always the ball rolling, you know. Every month we put on new features online, new stuff. And so I think one of the secrets is to keep the ball rolling and also to use the blogosphere for a good starting point, and also other channels, new channels like MySpace. It's a totally new channel. You have to deal with MySpace, for instance. Like you deal with bloggers, like you deal with search engines, like you deal with the press, with the newspapers, with television. And the third thing is, I totally agree that distribution is the key at the end of the day. So what we are looking for is also partnerships with large communities where we can simply put our call technology inside to expand and to fasten up the distribution.
Okay. Joe?
For a small to mid-sized business company, we're a little bit different. We do most of our marketing through direct marketing, primarily search engine marketing. So we're very, very good at measuring exactly what our subscriber acquisition costs are against a whole huge slew of keywords. We also do a ton of PR. So I would say about half our traffic is actually search engine marketing, search engine optimization, and the other half is PR, both in terms of pretty deeply in the blogosphere as well as traditional media.
Harry?
So LinkedIn spreads at currently 300,000 per month by people sending each other invitations.
300,000 more people sign up every month?
Yep.
So that's kind of involuntary, huh?
Actually, I think it's
very
voluntary.
I don't mean that as a negative thing.
No, it's from the business perspective, it's automatic. From someone enters in an email address and a name and deliberately invites a person, or a person deliberately signs up.
Okay. And what percentage of people sign up when they get invited?
I think currently the acceptance rate for the first invitation is around 35%.
Really?
Yep.
Wow. That's very high. I think it's very high, huh?
Okay, well, it comes from someone you know, usually. That's, I think, one of
the... problem is everybody thinks they know me, so... Yeah.
We don't?
You don't want to know. Lauren?
Well, we're, again, just in the startup area, and since we're going after a market that doesn't isn't necessarily web-enabled, well, they are web-enabled but not that comfortable with it, but we're building it very slowly and very directly. So we are going after individual segments of the market, establishing them as publishers and authors and editors, and hand-holding the whole process through, and doing this very carefully and very slowly and very methodically, and taking all their feedback. So ours is a very slow sort of, it's not really, it is viral, but it's a sort of direct marketed viral thing, and build the community that way.
Okay. Next question. Right behind you.
This question's for Alex specifically, actually. So you started your company outside of the Valley, and I was just wondering if you could give me some insight into maybe the pros and cons of starting something outside of the Valley.
Very nice question. Yes.
So there definitely is pros and cons. I think, you know, for me, the biggest pro was that, you know, I got to focus on the product. You know, it was my partner and I had started and, you know, soon started running out of money, so I brought on a friend and he put some money in, and we just continued to build. You know, we would be the guys at the gateway at 4 a.m. building servers, and it was, you know, there wasn't, everything was so real for us. It was, you know, it was really our passion, what we did, and we knew nothing else. I think, you know, here in the Valley, things seem, you know, a little different. It's, you know, it's definitely the talent is different. The expectations are much, much different. In Denver, there's not a lot of hot startups, and, you know, people love to come work at PhotoBucket. We've had zero voluntary turnover. People are just really, really passionate. Out here, you know, people are hopping around to the next great thing or what they think the next great thing is. And I think, you know, it's the networks, and, you know, the reason I moved out here was because there was so much going on as far as, you know, business development deals, partnerships, advertising deals. And it was a real disadvantage to the company to be in Denver from a business development standpoint. And, you know, one day the board said, hey, we think we may need a presence in Silicon Valley. And I made a deal with them, and I said, I'll go out there if I can live within 5 minutes of work, because I had heard these horror stories about commuting. So that was, you know, for me, coming out here, the big advantage was the network that you build. And, you know, to this day, I think that's really going to help the company out.
Okay, next question.
Joe, I'm interested, as a serial entrepreneur after Excite, how did you get the energy to do it again? And is there a third startup in you as well?
It's interesting. So when I left Excite, I put a backpack on because I had never done that. I wanted to do that right out of college. And my fiance, no, not the one with the Prius.
You got a lot to keep track of.
Yeah. We put backpacks on and traveled through Nepal and Vietnam and Cambodia, and I spent a lot of time surfing in Central and South America and just kind of decompressed. Later on, I met Peter Ubroth, the guy who ran the 1984 Olympics, an amazing guy, and I asked him how he had such an interesting and varied career, and the answer was when he finished a project, he potted plants. I was like, what on earth does that mean? And he literally goes into his garden and pots plants until he's so bored he can finally hear what his inner voice is telling him. He quiets down. So that was my process. I quieted down. And then my business partner and I decided we didn't want to start another company. We were very passionate about digital copyright reform. So we started a nonprofit lobbying effort called digitalconsumer.org. Signed up 50,000 people across the country, and I spent pretty much every third week in Washington, D.C., lobbying for digital copyright reform. And eventually got kind of potted enough plants that found that that voice was calling again to do another one. And the reason I do it, I mean, it's the reason I do it is hard to maybe believe, but it's very true for me, which is that nothing, you don't build relationships like you can with people in a startup with the shared struggle that comes with it. Like, I love going to work because of the people at JotSpot, and the shit, and what builds those relationships is the fact that we are all working towards the impossible, towards the improbable of making something like a startup unbelievably successful. That sense of shared struggle is what gets me up in the morning. So that's why I love it. That's why I really love it. And the difference this time around, to swing back to a question I had a bad answer for, celebrate your successes. I wish we had done that more. I really wish every little success you have, yes, it lead, you know, you've got to get up in the morning, the next morning, and compete on a new higher level. Celebrate your successes. I always forgot to do that.
Okay, next question.
So Mitch Kapoor, I think last September, asked a room this size here at his event, how many people have contributed to Wikipedia? And it was 2. He was kind of taking a pulse. I just wanted to ask that, and then
that's
I had a question for the panel. So how many people here have contributed to Wikipedia? Wow. Okay, it's a lot more than 2.
Maybe we have a better audience.
So I go to trend.
Better speakers.
Better moderator.
So my question for the panel is, a lot of you guys are into user-generated content. Even LinkedIn really is user-generated content. The question is, when does that stop, or where does that go with our lives? I mean, you know, how far does that go? And my other question is, Reed, when can I start deleting links with losers?
The answer is now. If you go to your contacts page, there's a remove connections thing in a yellow box on the right. And then the other piece, I actually think this is one of the things that's really, really exciting around what's going on Web 2.0 is I think it's unknown how far the whole user-generated content goes. You do need to have some improved editorial controls in some cases, but it's not clear that those editorial controls are, you know, boards of editors paid by media companies. So, you know, like one of the things that about Wikipedia I think is really interesting is, yes, there's a tax on it, and yes, of course, there are sometimes weird articles or corrupted in certain ways, but the massive size of good content, and in terms of the, you know, average, you know, amount of like being able to find something pretty compelling, pretty interesting, pretty accurate, is just stunning on as simple a platform as the Wikimedia platform is with its community. And I think that, I mean, one of the ways I characterized in 03 the kinds of companies that I was investing in is, what happens when you have millions of publishers?
Yeah, baby.
So. That's a good segue. Thank you very much. I mean, I don't think that it has started with the users' content. I mean, the amount of personal, everybody in here, the amount of personal interests they have or stories or opinions that are just as valid as the mainstream media or the mainstream media's comments, all of that has yet to be enabled particularly. I mean, every one of you, I'll bet, I mean, how much you interact is just beginning. I think this is the whole, you know, I've sat and listened to the arguments between the bloggers and the mainstream media and journalists who have been in there 20 years. I don't think it's a particular argument. I think there's space for all of it. I mean, the good content. I mean, I think the models will change. I mean, we're beginning on the revenue sharing model because at some point somebody's going to say, well, wait a minute, this is all of our content on the web and you guys are making all the money by sticking the ads in there. And I think that's very true. But I think it has yet been touched about all the stories all of us have to tell and all of our lives that we, all the things that we do every day. I think it's absolutely untouched.
I heard an amazing stat from Peter Hirschberg over at Technorati, and I have no idea how he got this statistic, so I'm going to pass it on as completely true. but the statistic was that 20% of the media that teens are digesting today are created by their peers. 20%. Unbelievable. That, to me, is a very powerful force. So,
next question. Oh.
Hi. What is the best place to register a startup? The choices are Delaware, Nevada, California, the Cayman Islands, or China. Thank you.
we should let Fenwick answer this. Where's Fenwick, Mercy? How much would you charge to answer that?
Oh, yeah.
So he said Delaware. Any other opinions here?
I think it depends. I mean, we started out, is an LLC. And there was actually early on, there was some great, great tax benefits to that. As you meet the venture firms and, you know, you get a little bigger, they force you to hire a legal team and go and convert to a C Corp or whatever it is.
In Delaware.
Yeah, in Delaware, of course, yeah.
Delaware, right? Okay, yeah. You save $425. That was just a demo. Okay, well, next question? Yes. Take care of our sponsors.
Are any of you guys working 8 to 5? And if not, then why not? I mean, at some point, are you able to manage your time?
What's the question?
That's a great question.
Is any of you working 8 to 5? I usually ask that when I get interviewed, like, can I be successful in this company? I used to say 40 hours a week. Now I tweaked it up to 50. And I usually kind of get, yeah, you're welcome to work from home. Like, and that's not what I want necessarily. And I'm from Europe, obviously. But
let's talk about that.
The answer, one of the ways that I look at startups before you get profitable and also before you've basically established yourself relative to your competition, both of those things, because sometimes you're profitable but you're still in the thick of things. Or whether you still have a run to go, you're basically walking dead, right? You're reanimated by financing, but your fundamental inertia is dead. So given that, when you're walking dead, you run, right? And so now you have to realize it's more of a marathon than a sprint, right? So if you burn yourself out in a month, you know, you just tripped over yourself and you killed yourself, and that's kind of dumb. But you know, basically, I think what you actually, I really look at it as much more like a marathon. And so, you know, if you're working 100 hours a week, you know, you're probably going to burn out too fast. But if you're working less, you know, roughly than 60 or 70, you're probably not doing enough if you can do more. I mean, that's, you know, and then that persists until you basically get your company in flight where it's no longer walking dead.
Okay, any other...
I have a different approach, you know. You said 8 to 5. We say 5 to 8, this is the time you sleep. As long as you can sustain it, right? And you take some Red Bull.
Well, you want us to end?
You're done.
What? Are you paying this country club by hour? Nobody's leaving. You want to keep going or, I don't know. You know, I got a TiVo, I don't care. Okay, how about two more questions? This is Jeff Yang look-alike here. That's a compliment. He's rich, he's good-looking, lives in Atherton.
So you guys are out there right now. There's a lot of hype around Web 2.0. If you're being contrarian, what's real about Web 2.0, and what do you actually think the real opportunities are that we aren't thinking about?
How do I know what you're thinking about?
This is like asking an alcoholic what's he think
it's
of
like
booze.
It's like Karnak. No. I don't know. I expressed some of this, I think, a little bit earlier, but I can take nothing away from... I can't pinpoint any particular trend that I'm not good enough to pinpoint any particular trend that I think is the winning one in Web 2.0, other than I think it's a great phenomenon because it is cheap innovation. I mean, that to me is the big takeaway from Web 2.0, is just massive amounts of companies and products being created, and as a result, we're kind of exploring the total number of spaces much faster than we could in the past.
Okay. Any more?
I mean, there's a lot of kind of idiot Web 2.0 is just the next gen, et cetera, and that's all garbage, but actually there's tons of user-generated content. I actually think there's lots of things interesting in, like, for example, take social networking, professional networking, bringing relationships that exist in the real world in utility ways on the web. I think that there's lots of things happening in collaborative filtering and that kind of stuff. I think a bunch of the vertical search stuff is interesting. You know, basically, you know, one of the things that's gotten a little trendy is to say, you know, the Web 2.0 stuff is a little overhyped because there are instances definitely of it. But actually, I think it's really just the beginning of a whole set of 5 to 10 years of interesting trends and things that change the world for consumers.
Okay. We'll take one. You have anybody else? Okay. We'll take one last question here, this gentleman here.
So at a conference talk recently, Tim Draper, the venture capitalist, on the topic of what advice to give entrepreneurs, startup entrepreneurs, Tim Draper said that his advice to his companies always was, don't sell, don't sell, don't sell, until, you know, it gets to be $1 billion, you know, Skype, Hotmail, and so on.
Spoken like a true portfolio theorist.
Exactly.
Well, right. And then the mic was next handed to Jason Calacanis of Weblogs Inc., which he had just sold to AOL for an amount much less than what Tim Draper sold Skype to eBay for, a company that he had bootstrapped. And he said his advice was not to work with venture capitalists like Tim Draper. Because
Sounds like Jason.
Yeah.
Right. Because as an entrepreneur in a startup company, you don't have the luxury of portfolio management that you do have as a venture capitalist. So this is a tension that's been commented on often, but I'd be interested in your, you know, all of your perspectives on that problem.
So I think, you know, when we looked at venture capital in general, it was one of those things where, to me, it was just math, right? I mean, like we first looked at it, you know, 2 years ago, it was simple math on, you know, how much money do we need? How long can that get us? What is a possible outcome? I think in general, there's all this hype and all this excitement and all these other things that people put around it. But at the end of the day, you know, you look at the simple formulas, and then you combine that with the people that you really want to work with. And I think, you know, I used to get so bent out of shape, oh, an extra percent here or there. In the end, none of that really matters. I think that finding the firms you really want to work with and, you know, taking money when you need money, not taking more than you need, I think, and really looking at, you know, from the outside, looking at the opportunities as you grow, you'll do what's right, I think.
I'll frame it with a particular piece of advice. Generally speaking, startups are always the same amount of insane work. So the recommendation I give entrepreneurs is try to do something that, in fact, has at least a gamble at a really big upside. And as such, I am generally actually pretty supportive of taking venture money. I completely agree with Alex. Choose the person you want to work with. You know, make sure you have a good relationship with them. Frequently, getting financed with a venture capitalist is like getting married after 2 PowerPoint presentations and a dinner.
You didn't even get a book?
Exactly. You know, it's important to be careful about it, but generally speaking, because you know, there are a lot of uncertain outcomes in the same amount of work, generally speaking, try to pick a path that, you know, could have kind of a zero outcome, always possible, could have a small outcome, could have a moderate outcome, could have a big outcome. And given that distribution, usually venture financing makes sense.
I guess I would say a couple of things. One is the portfolio thing is totally clear. I think that in any conversation like this, it is most of the time, the vast majority of the time, in my opinion, the role of the venture investor to say don't sell. Because, again, they have a portfolio of things, and the downside risk is completely known. They know exactly how much they've invested, but the upside risk is completely unknown. So it's usually always worth, in any individual instance, to push for maximum upside. But the second thing to remember is that actually, I think the insiders, the founders of a company, have a lot more power than they think. I don't mean this in any offense to any of the venture capitalists in the room. But it's very difficult in a portfolio, think about it from their perspective, in a portfolio theory, in a portfolio environment, their ability to spend a huge amount of time on your company, if everybody says, we want to sell, and they say no, what's the choice? They have to spend a lot of time with you now, because you're gone, and they've got to be running the show. That's not an easy decision. So actually, there is, the insiders actually have a tremendous amount of power in that regard. The thing, actually, Reed told me this. Reed is a much more successful investor than I am. And Reed made a really good point, which I'll repeat for him.
Took the words right out of his mouth.
Yes. I mean, it was basically about the risk of, consider the risk of taking venture capital as an entrepreneur, which is that there are a tremendous number of buyers anywhere between $0 and $15 million for your company. There are very few buyers at kind of $50 to $250 million. That's a much more rarefied air. You take VC, you suddenly have to have a successful